Good afternoon. It's my pleasure to welcome you to today's conversation. In 2018, the American Academy began the work of the Bipartisan Commission on the Practice of Democratic Citizenship, which sought to address the weaknesses and vulnerabilities in our political and civic life. After 2 years of engagement with communities from all over the US, the commission's final report, Our Common Purpose, Reinventing American Democracy for the 21st Century, was released in June 2020. The report offers 31 bold recommendations across 6 strategies to help the nation emerge as a more resilient democracy by 2026. One of those strategies calls for dramatically expanding the capacity of civic leaders and civil society groups to bring people together and build bridges across lines of difference. The report reflects the despair that the commissioners encountered over the lack of trust Americans have in one another and the sense that nothing unites us, but it also conveys optimism about what is possible if we can scale up the successful efforts to foster connection and bridge divides that are happening in communities across the country. Today's program will be an opportunity to highlight what's at stake and share ideas for alleviating that despair. In the spirit of the work of the commission, we are joined by a distinguished cross-partisan panel. I would like to welcome Representatives Andy Barr and Derek Kilmer, as well as author and former diplomat Farah Pandith, Ambassador Kay Bailey Hutchison, and Middlebury College President Laurie Patton. We are grateful to our panelists for bringing their distinctive perspectives to this conversation. I also want to express gratitude for today's moderator, Eric Liu, President and CEO of Citizen University and co-chair of the Commission on the Practice of Democratic Citizenship. Eric is also director of the Aspen Institute's Citizenship and American Identity Program and the author of many books, including most recently, Become America, Civic Sermons on Love, Responsibility, and Democracy. He's an engine of powerful ideas about the ways we can remake our civic culture, and he has worked tirelessly on behalf of the commission to help heal the divides in our nation. Eric was elected to the Academy in 2020. We're lucky to have him leading the commission and driving today's conversation. Eric, I'll turn things over to you.
David, thank you so much for that introduction. Thanks to all of our distinguished panelists for joining us today, and thanks to all of you for being part of this hour that's going to be jam-packed and so rich and, I think, inspiring. You know, one of the privileges of co-chairing this bipartisan commission at the Academy that created this report, I always love to have a hard copy here in front of me, Our Common Purpose, was the opportunity to hear from Americans around the country about their hopes and their fears, their dreams, their aspirations for our society, for our constitutional democracy, and what it means to them right now to be a citizen, to live like a citizen in our fractured and changing society. And as David mentioned, we heard real concerns everywhere we went. We did 50 plus listening sessions all around the United States in all kinds of settings, rural and urban, communities of immigrants and military academies, workplaces, you name it, college campuses. And everywhere we went, we heard profound concerns about how divided we've become as a people. At the same time, we heard a yearning for connection, for common purpose, and for more opportunities to help actually bridge some of these divides, particularly locally. The old adage that all politics is local, I think, is being tested right now on left and right as more and more of political and civic life gets nationalized and weaponized in nationalized ways. But I think one of the things that people are yearning for right now is just a rehumanizing, a reconnection to people around them, whether neighbors, whether kin, whether colleagues, and an ability to actually live together. And inspired by those conversations, we included recommendations in our report, in Our Common Purpose, to dramatically expand what we call civic bridging capacity. This means investment in the people, the programs, and the places in our local communities that actually enable others to associate, solve problems, and manage difference in healthy ways. You could think of this as civic infrastructure. And indeed, one of the proposals in the report is really to launch a national initiative to get more people involved in the building of this kind of civic infrastructure, which may not take the form of hard bridges and steel trusses, but is just as important to the viability and sustainability of our communities. One of the key insights in our report is that the health of our constitutional democracy depends not only on reforming political institutions, but also on revitalizing civic culture. that culture in so many ways, so many times, and this is what we teach in our work at Citizen University, culture precedes structure. Culture, by which we mean the norms, values, habits, narratives, mindsets, and heartsets by which we live together, often determines the frame of the possible when you get to policy debates or structural reform ideas. And people are remembering right now that we've got to tend to culture. We've got to not only pay attention to what's going on in policymaking, but also the ways in which we build muscle, rebuild those habits of association, rejoin what Alexis de Tocqueville spoke of as the little platoons of democracy, and start showing up for each other and with each other. And that work towards civic renewal is happening all across the country. I want to just situate this conversation today, not only in our times, which are, of course, incredibly polarized and divided. You need only to think about the most recent presidential election, January 6th, but you need also to just think about the last couple of days. We are gathered here today, just a couple of days after a horrible, horrific tragedy in Buffalo, an act of racist hate, an act, I would submit, of domestic terrorism, but an act fundamentally that did not come out of the blue, because it was part and parcel of a culture of alienation, a culture of scapegoating, a culture in which people decide to dehumanize in the most radical ways. And this opportunity we have right now in every institution, at home, at school, on college campuses, in workplaces, with the younger generation in particular, to actually get at some of the deeper reasons why people have come to make choices like that murderer did this weekend, and why people have made choices like so many other Americans have, which is to say, well, that's another thing that I can't do anything about. Well, that's another problem that at the end of the day is someone else's problem. We are waking up to the fact that there is no such thing right now in our democracy as someone else's problem. And I think on the global stage as well, Vladimir Putin's invasion of Ukraine has also heightened for us our awareness of the stakes, not only because so many Americans are inspired by the Ukrainians' courageous response to help unify and defend their nation, but also because that fight reminds us that words like freedom, self-government, self-determination, liberty are not just words. They are words that we have to imbue with meaning and commitment. And today's conversation is going to be about how we do that, how we not just say the words, but live the words of community, country, and connection. And our conversation today will highlight bipartisan legislation in Congress, efforts in college campuses and elsewhere to build capacity to address division, and also the contexts within which all of these fights and all of these challenges unfold, and the risks to our own national security, our domestic stability, and our position in the world right now. So what we're going to do actually is sequentially engage several of our incredibly distinguished panelists and guests here. And our first chunk of time is going to be spent with our two members of Congress joining us here, Congressman Barr and Kilmer, who you've been introduced to. And I just want to take a point of pride here. Congressman Kilmer is from my state of Washington. And Congressman Barr is from a state that I love and that Citizen University does a great deal of work with, and that is Kentucky. They are, as you can Google them and read about their bios, incredibly different in their political points of view, and yet incredibly similar in their underlying commitment to our constitutional democracy and our underlying commitment to actually building relationships that can transcend some of the other divisions here. Congressman Barr has represented Kentucky's 6th Congressional District since 2013. He's a senior member of the House Financial Services Committee and is the ranking member of the National Security, International Development, and Monetary Policy Subcommittee. He also serves on the House Foreign Affairs Committee. Congressman Kilmer has represented Washington's 6th Congressional District since 2013. He serves on the House Appropriations Committee and was appointed to serve as the chair of the House, as the Select Committee on the Modernization of Congress. And I'm noting, Congressman Barr, I think my talking points might be wrong. I believe you were elected in 2010, not 2012. But in any case, you're a member of long standing. And Congressman, thank you both for joining us. And you're both co-chairs, actually, of something that sounds like it's from ancient history. It's called the bipartisan working group. People today might not believe such a thing exists anymore in the United States Congress, but you can assure us that it does. And you've helped to introduce bipartisan legislation to bridge divides and address polarization. And I want to ask you both the same question. And Congressman Barr, I'll put these questions to you first, because I know that you may have some committee business that may pull you away sooner than the end of our program. But the first question I want to pose to you both is, why? Why did you decide to focus on this issue? Why did you decide, what did you see at stake? And what have you heard from people in your districts, which are very different places in America, about the need to address this kind of polarization? Congressman Barr, let's start with you.
Well, first of all, Eric, thank you so much for your work at Citizen University, and thank you for the report that you have produced to incentivize and encourage that civic infrastructure building. And I'm honored to be joined by my good friend, Derek Kilmer. We are classmates. We came into the Congress together, I believe, after 2012. I really enjoyed co-chairing the bipartisan working group with Derek, and it is, in fact, a real thing, even in today's divisive and polarized country. And I really credit Derek for his leadership on introducing this legislation, which you referred to, the Building Civil Bridges Act, which will encourage local organizations to create and maintain solid, lasting personal relationships across differences. And I'll just have to say, and I think Derek was there as well, I just came from the House floor where we heard a terrific speech from the Prime Minister of the Hellenic Republic, the world's first democracy, an address to the People's House in what many consider to be the most powerful and innovative democracy, the United States. And he made an interesting observation about both of our democracies, and that is that the threats to our democracies are in many ways more from internal disintegration and less from external threats, even as we witness the horrors of a tyrannical aggression in Ukraine. And so we have a lot of work to do to maintain and sustain our democracies. And I think that's what this project is all about. And I think Derek can tell you about this. I was personally inspired to join this legislation by a constituent organization, the Henry Clay Center for Statesmanship, located in my district in Lexington, Kentucky. The Henry Clay Center was established to educate current and future leaders in the value and tools of civil discourse and beneficial compromise. The seat in Congress that I'm privileged to hold, representing the people of Central and Eastern Kentucky, has existed for more than 200 years. And of the many statesmen that have held the office before me, the most famous man, of course, to hold this seat, and arguably the greatest American legislator in history, was Henry Clay, Speaker of the House. And Henry Clay's personal and professional accomplishments are myriad, but he is probably best remembered as the great compromiser. And I take the responsibility of representing this seat and that legacy very, very seriously, because Clay was a man who had an unwavering dedication to and a practice of open dialogue and civil engagement. Now, that is not to say Clay did not have political adversaries or rivalries or even arguably political enemies. He had a fierce rivalry and a very tense relationship with Andrew Jackson. Just go back and review the history of the election of 1824, and you'll see all of that. In fact, I think Jackson once referred to the election of 1824 as the corrupt bargain in which John Quincy Adams became president and Henry Clay became his Secretary of State when the House of Representatives ultimately decided that election, the House of Representatives over which Henry Clay presided as Speaker of the House. So there's a lot of history there. But he understood his responsibility as a statesman to advance beneficial compromise for the sake of the general welfare, not to deny differences of opinion and the fact, and not to pretend that there are not conflicts. In fact, we just know the founding of our country, there were many compromises to actually create the Constitution, and there was much conflict. And it is my belief that we as a nation must return to this idea that we're not denying our differences. We shouldn't deny the fact that we have conflict and different philosophies and political ideas, But freedom tolerates and accommodates that pluralism. It accommodates and takes into account the fact that we're very, very different. And the founding ideal that what makes us a nation, what makes us cohesive, is not our political party, our political philosophy, our religion, our national origin, or any immutable characteristics, but rather what binds us in the United States, in our democracy, is our dedication to our legal republic and the pluralism within the rule of law. Inscribed on the Great Seal of the United States is the Latin phrase, e pluribus unum, out of many, one. And this phrase was approved as the motto of the United States in 1776, the same year the Declaration of Independence was signed. It reflects an important truth that our nation was founded as a nation of differences and represents the unity of a country of people from different backgrounds and different beliefs. We are stronger when we embrace our diversity as one nation together. And that's why this legislation is so important. That's why I believe in it. It's an effort to help us return to the ideas of our founding fathers who warned us about factions and divisions in Federalist Paper number 10, and who believed that unfettered and robust civil discourse and debate on public opinions were foundational to the creation and success of our great nation. And so just to conclude my thoughts here, we are, as a nation, we must move beyond this idea that division is inherently evil, but recognize that our constitutional design, our constitutional system was set up to actually encourage and accommodate the difference of opinion, but resolve those peacefully through institutions that we need to defend. Institutions like courts, institutions like the Congress and local government and state government, legislative and the ballot box, democracy, resolving our differences peacefully in those ways and through civil discourse, respecting others even when we disagree with one another. So we shouldn't fall into the temptation of cancel culture, canceling the founding. The founding is what is actually binds us together as a nation. And Republicans, Democrats, conservatives, liberals, moderates, progressives, all of us should respect this brilliant system of democracy, of checks and balances, of federalism, of separation of powers, which actually accommodates our freedom and allows us to disagree with one another in a civil way. And so I just am so proud to be part of this project that I think will help build up that civic infrastructure that will help us reclaim our appreciation for what makes our country great. And that includes our differences.
Well, Congressman, thank you so much for not only the passion that you're bringing to this, but situating us in history. And in a moment, Congressman Kilmer, I want to invite you to actually unpack a little bit what's in this legislation that you and Congressman Barr and others have been putting forward. But I just want to note, Congressman Barr, you know, that the American Academy itself, as you may know, actually precedes many of the institutions in the United States. It was in 1780, as the Revolutionary War was being fought, that a few farsighted people like John Adams and John Hancock said, you know what, I think we're going to win this thing. And when we do, we can't just pat ourselves on the back and get on with our lives status quo ante. We've actually got to build institutions and make sure we are a people and a nation capable of self-government. We ought to create something which ended up becoming called the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, to ensure that we have a people capable of self-government in this constitutional scheme and in what would ultimately emerge under the Constitution. The thing that I want to say, though, is that your example of Henry Clay and the legacy that you hold there really underscores something that goes straight, Congressman Kilmer, to this legislation, which is that bridge building is not necessarily finding common ground or the areas where people of left and right or Republican and Democrat agree. They can still disagree. They can still actually have quite sharp disagreements in principle and worldview and priority. But the question is, how do you actually span those differences? And Congressman Kilmer, will you just tell us in a word, what's in this legislation? What will it do? And why is it that you and others were moved to put this forward?
You bet. Well, first of all, thanks, Eric, for your leadership on this. And thanks for having me here with my good friend, Andy Barr, who's been a terrific partner with the Bipartisan Working Group and on this legislation. I'll start with the second thing you asked, which is why. I think all of us are conscious of some of the divides in our nation right now. There was a recent NBC News poll that found that 70% of the American public now believes we are incapable of, as a country, of solving big problems because we are so divided. Andy mentioned our national motto right before the pandemic. I had the pleasure of seeing Ken Burns speak at the Library of Congress, where he said, sometimes it feels like we have a lot of pluribus, but not a lot of unum. And I think we're conscious of that dynamic. For me, you know, and there are groups working on this, not just AAAS, but groups like the Interfaith Youth Corps and others that have been in convergence that have had their oars in the water on this for a while. For me, the catalyst for this was a couple things that happened in my district. Unfortunately, this fall, we saw a series of attacks on religious institutions in Tacoma. We saw the Islamic Center burned to the ground by an arsonist. We saw two Buddhist faith leaders get assaulted outside their temple. We saw a church get vandalized, all within the span of just a few weeks. And in the spirit of something good coming out of something bad, you saw the interfaith community basically pull together, host an event to say, that's not what we're about, that we're, while we have diversity of views, we are united in our belief that people ought to be able to pray to whatever God they wish to without having to fear for violence or conflict. And it was a terrific event where the message was pretty clear that part of living in a religiously diverse, pluralistic democracy is the ability to live next to people who think and look and pray differently than you do. And afterwards, one of the faith leaders approached me and said, you know, that was a pretty good hour, but if we're going to do this right, we should really do it on an ongoing basis with our community. And he said, just out of curiosity, is there any federal support for something like that? And I said, you know what? Not really, at least not currently. About a month later, I got invited to visit a YMCA in my district, thinking they were going to talk to me about the fact that gymnasiums were losing money and that there's some federal legislation to help with that. It's not what they wanted to talk about. They said, you know, all the polarization that you see in Congress, that we see on cable news, has unfortunately infested our YMCA. They said, we've literally had arguments and even fights break out over pick your red or blue issue. And they said, it's become so bad, we can't ignore it anymore. So we've actually hired a consultant that's going to train our staff, train our board in conflict resolution, that we're going to actually host some events to try to get people talking and listening across these divides, rather than having our interactions turn into the Jerry Springer show. And they said, just out of curiosity, any federal support for something like that? And I said, you know, not really. And at the same time, as you mentioned in your intro, Eric, I chair a new committee in Congress called the Select Committee on the Modernization of Congress, which is nicknamed the Fixed Congress Committee. I'd ask all those listening to pray for us. But chapter 4 of your report was on strengthening civic bridge building. And it points out that the United States, through the National Endowment for Democracy, spends tens of millions of dollars each year trying to support fostering social cohesion and build civic bridges as a means of strengthening democracy in other countries, but that we don't do it here in the United States. And this bill is really a reaction to that, to say, perhaps we should. So we would set up a pilot program through AmeriCorps, and we chose AmeriCorps in part because it has footprints in most of our communities, and in part because it's a unique federal agency in that it can accept private philanthropy. And it would be a pilot that would empower AmeriCorps, one, to do some grant making to these hyper-local efforts, the interfaith effort in Tacoma, the local YMCA, the Interfaith Youth Corps on a college campus, or any other number of organizations that are working in this space. Two, to train AmeriCorps members in the skills related to bridge building. And three, to Andy's point about the Henry Clay Center, to support colleges and universities that are doing research and work in this space. So that's the rationale behind the bill. Part of my excitement for it is that when we introduced it with 10 Democrats and 10 Republicans. And so I think we've got good bipartisan support for it. For anybody who's watching, I encourage you, help us amplify the importance of this. Reach out to your members of Congress, reach out to the Education and Labor Committee, help them understand that this is an important endeavor if we're going to be serious about protecting and strengthening American democracy.
You know, Congressman, you've both referred to each other here as my friend Andy, my friend Derek. And anybody who spent any time around Washington knows, oh, you know, those are the kinds of words people use when they actually are about to, you know, stick the knife in their back or whatever, right? My friend. And number one, it's true in your case, my friend. But I think the second thing that really comes out here in what both of you are talking about is that so much of this work is about rehumanizing and responsibility taking, right? That constitutional scheme, Congressman Barr, that you're describing works only if we end up taking responsibility at the level that your constituents, Congressman Kilmer, did at the YMCA, right? They didn't sit around and think, oh my goodness, you know, these national problems have infected us. What do? We're helpless. They started finding people who could be mediators. They started figuring out ways to take ownership, and they turned to you for, okay, well, you know, how can the national government help us? And I think, you know, sort of in the same category as my friend, Congressman X, you know, is the phrase elected leader. And you two actually prove, you are the exceptions to the rule. I would submit that in many cases, elected leaders are actually really exquisitely attuned followers and sensing which way the wind is blowing, sensing where the heat is in their constituencies or in their districts. And look, to get reelected, you both have enough of that in you. But what you are here is actual leaders. You are leading by example in ways that probably create a little discomfort for your respective caucus mates and maybe for some of your constituencies. Like, what are you talking to that guy on that side for? Don't you know how that guy voted on the Affordable Care Act? Don't you know how that guy feels about abortion? Don't you know, where that guy stands on these issues? And it is only by leadership, by example, whether at the level of congresspeople or at the level of everyday Americans, that we're going to actually turn this thing right now. And so I just want to appreciate you both, not only for advancing this legislation, but for showing us what it can look like. Again, I invite people who are on this webinar, go Google both these members and see how in many ways diametrically opposed they are on a whole host of policy issues. And that they can find not only an opportunity for civic friendship, but for constructive civic bridge building, using the power at their disposal as members of Congress, should kind of spur the rest of us to think about what power do we have at our disposal to take on that example where we live. Congressman, thank you both so much for joining us today. And I know you both have other votes and other demands, but we're so glad to have you and have your example here. And in a moment, I'm going to turn now to our other panelists. Thank you both.
Thank you, Eric.
Thank you, Eric. And yes, we are genuine and actual friends as well.
Good to see you, Andy.
It's about finding overlapping interests, even when we sometimes disagree. Thank you very much.
Thank you both. Thank you for leading by example.
Thanks.
Well, I want to pivot here now to our other panel today and the balance of our time here, which is really focused on bridging divides to strengthen United States national security. And the second panel will talk about why efforts like the Building Civic Bridges Act that the two members of Congress just described there as lead sponsors of, and other such efforts, whether legislative or purely citizen-driven to bridge divides, why such efforts right now are so important and timely, not just in general, but in particular to our national security. And this is an angle that I think, again, has become maybe 2, 3, 5 years ago, people would have said, wait, what? Why are you talking about domestic politics and national security this way? We're talking about, you know, U.S. civic participation. This isn't a foreign policy question. But what's been unfolding in the world in the last few years, and certainly since Russia's invasion of Ukraine, I think has sharpened our awareness of how these things are interconnected, as of course has the pandemic and the ways in which different countries, including our own, have or have not responded well to the challenges of the pandemic to put to the test the question of, are we in it together? Can we make an unum out of a pluribus? And so to begin this panel here, I'm going to begin actually with Ambassador Kay Bailey Hutchison, who I'm pleased to introduce now. Ambassador Hutchison, we were joking before the cameras started rolling that you don't know whether to call her ambassador, senator, the honorable, awesome Kay Bailey Hutchison. But Ambassador Hutchison served as U.S. permanent representative to NATO from 2017 until 2021. And prior to that, she represented Texas in the United States Senate from 1993 to 2013. Serving as chair of the Republican Policy Committee and as ranking member of the Senate Committee on Commerce, Science, and Transportation. She's been a leading voice both in and out of government, particularly now in this time of turmoil about connecting these dots between domestic social cohesion and U.S. national security. Ambassador Hutchison, it's so great to have you with us. And I want to begin just by asking you, why is it on the most basic level, make the case for me why bridging divides here at home is important to strengthening U.S. National security and enhancing our position of leadership in the world.
Eric, it is a great question that you are posing, because most people would say, well, that doesn't matter to foreign policy. It matters so much in foreign policy. And let me tell you two things. First of all, the good news part of this is that on the biggest issue that we're facing as the NATO alliance, as our partners around the world that have Western democracies face a Russia that is invading a sovereign nation by force and using horrific methods to do so. And our Western world is united. Our Congress is united in a very bipartisan way. The support for Ukraine and standing firm against this Russian invasion is bipartisan. That's the good news. But the question is so relevant because I have heard now so many times from either colleagues in NATO or from our adversaries or would-be adversaries like Russia or China say, well, you can't ever count on a democracy because it changes so much. And you see this divide. And in fact, Russia uses cyber attacks to divide our NATO countries by highlighting their diversity of views and their disagreements on issues. So if there's a tough issue in a country, Russia will use it to go in with a cyber on both sides of the equation and raise the rhetoric for the two sides to make it worse. And President Xi of China has said, well, you can see now why an autocracy is the better form of government because it is more stable, it is more reliable than these countries like America that have so much division. So you see that when you can't show that you can come together and address major issues and solve them in a peaceful way, that it is used by our adversaries, but it also raises questions about just what we can do with our friends and our allies. And I think that one of the hallmarks that was mentioned in the by the congressman in the historic viewpoint is that we have had huge divisions in our country before, but we have been able to solve those issues without firing a shot, that we've been able to do it without civil disruption. But today, you couldn't really say that. You can't say that we are solving our issues of a peaceful takeover, a transition of power. You can't really say that we don't have disruptions when you see riots in the streets and people breaking windows and stealing from businesses, even small businesses, on camera. That's not civil discourse. That is not law and order. It isn't the spirit that built our country. So it does affect foreign policy. It affects both our relationships with our allies, wondering, well, what is going to come next? Are the Republicans and Democrats going to agree on major issues? Yes, is the answer right now. In Ukraine, Republicans and Democrats are strongly supporting Ukraine to send our arms to Ukraine for their support to be able to fight a war themselves. Yes, we are. But when it comes to something like Afghanistan, for instance, and the exit from Afghanistan, our allies think, well, my goodness, what should we rely on in America? And those are our allies, while our adversaries are trying to sow discourse and divide us as nations in order to gain the strength to do their bad deeds.
Well, you know, Ambassador, something very chilling in what you said there about our adversaries sowing discord that way. You know, in past times of division, you think about the 1930s, a time when autocracies around the world were saying, oh, democracy's done, democracy's too, you know, dissolute, and they can't get their act together, and they're decadent, and you know, we autocracies, we authoritarians, we make the trains run on time, right? And that was the language then. But that at that time, countries like Nazi Germany or fascist Italy did not have the means to sow division here in the United States. It was not so easy as it is today because of technology, because of globalization, to divide us. And the word that struck me as you were speaking, Ambassador, is exploitable. We Americans are so exploitable right now in our division. And that is a dangerous and a chilling thing. And that brings me, I want to bring in to the conversation Farah Pandith now, who's a senior fellow at the Belfer Center at Harvard University and at the Council on Foreign Relations. And she's the author of How We Win, How Cutting-Edge Entrepreneurs, Political Visionaries, Enlightened Business Leaders, and Social Media Mavens Can Defeat the Extremist Threat. She served under both Presidents Bush and Obama, including at the National Security Council, the State Department, and as the first special representative to Muslim communities. And she served on the Department of Homeland Security's Advisory Council, chairing its task force on countering violent extremism. Farah Pandith, I'm really glad to see you after knowing your work from afar. I'm really sad that I'm seeing you when we have such a vivid, very recent example of violent extremism in our headlines, of course, the community of Buffalo, New York. But I want to just pivot to you now and ask, what do you see at stake in terms of our domestic security? How does this, you know, increasing baseline level of everyday toxic polarization, tribalism, dehumanization in our politics contribute to violent extremism in our society?
Eric, one of the things that's most sobering about this moment in time is that hate is a growth industry. And what we are seeing, the exposure you mentioned in your opening comments, I mean, there are many factors that are bringing us to this moment. COVID is just one of them, but we have seen the exposure of societal sinkholes. And to the point that the ambassador raised, you know, our adversaries see this, but also our fellow American citizens see this. Nothing is hidden. We know exactly what's going on. We see the numbers of people affected by violent extremism, even in this past week. We see the numbers of people who are distrustful of others. Our communities are changed, and the way in which we think about ourselves as Americans have changed. The work that we've incorporated in the 20 years since 9/11 about looking at the ideologies of us versus them tells us a couple of really important things. First is there is no domestic versus international. The ideology of us versus them is global. Things that happen in parts of Europe around neo-Nazis is impacting who we are here in America, how people raise money, how they're organized, how they think about their identity. Similarly, things that are what we might consider to be quite American are going in other parts of the world. People are feeding off of each other. So we're living in this moment, this ecosystem that is connected, as you rightly said, online with the swish of your finger. We are seeing different things. But what's at stake is who we are. The country that we think of as America, the ability to be who you are and live the way you want to live within the norms of our laws, has been affected. And what's very serious and dangerous about this moment is that there isn't a movement at scale to be able to combat this change. And what we're looking at today is not just adversaries that are taking advantage of this moment and stoking the fires and understanding how to make make this moment count for them, but we're seeing different parts of America think about themselves as different. Whether that is a religious difference, whether that's an ideological difference, whether that's a gender difference, and so on. So this work that we must do connecting to violent extremism is very serious, because not only are we in a country where guns are easily available, but what we've learned, what fellow citizens have learned, is 20 years worth of how to recruit and how to radicalize, what you must do to raise money, how to think about moving your ideas into a violent way. We saw that on January 6th. We're going to see more of this. So when I think about this question and the seriousness of this moment, I think, well, what have we learned in the 20 years of combating violent extremism? What do we know we can do? It's not all hopeless, right? And this thing of something that happened in, you know, Florida, or something that happened in Buffalo, or the rise of AAPI hate, or the rise of anti-Semitism, these aren't one-offs. It's part of an ecosystem that's connected to each other. Here's what we know. We cannot decrease the impact of hate and extremism if we don't go all in. We know that a focused attention doesn't just require solutions from government, as important as government is, but it takes all of us, not just faith leaders, not just educators, but every part of society. We know that. We know that we need to do it at scale. We know that we need to think about not just the pointy tip of the spear, but everything that happens in between, which means, how are we teaching Gen Alpha, Gen Z, and millennials? So for me, this is the most important thing we must be thinking about, not just from the security point of view, which is vital, but from the baseline who we are as Americans and the country we want to be.
Farah, thank you so much. There are two things that you just said that not only allow me to segue to Lori Patton here in a moment, but I really want to underscore here who we are. Who is us, right? The conception in a time of ever proliferating border crossing ideas of us versus them, you know, the unum that Congressman Barr was reminding us about, you know, the challenge of our time right now is that previous times where we had division, as Ambassador Hutchison said, previous times where we dealt with really deep conflict in nonviolent ways and were able to address those, we're, let's be honest, those were times where none of us in this panel would have been part of the polity. None of us would have been, you know, in the room where it happened. None of us would have been in a panel or at a table like this. And this is, we are living through a case of first impression right now to create a mass multiracial democratic republic that is inclusive of everybody hasn't been done or sustained in any society. And so, you know, that's number one, the question of how do we define an us that doesn't get boiled down to a lot of tribal identities, but is about some deeper civic connection of us. But the second thing you said, that this is about how we raise and expose the rising generation to habits, norms, and narratives of a bigger us. And that is the perfect segue to Lori Patton, the president of Middlebury College, the first woman to lead the institution, to be in that room where things happen. And under Patton's leadership, under Lori's leadership, Middlebury recently received the largest programmatic grant in the college's history, $25 million grant for the Katherine Wasserman Davis Collaborative in Conflict Transformation, where students learn and practice different approaches to conflict management and resolution. And this is, I think, not an accident. President Patton is an authority on South Asian history, culture, and religion in the public square, as a former president of the American Academy of Religion, and someone who's been thinking about how difference, sectarian and otherwise, plays out either productively in a pluralistic society or harmfully in one that can't actually find a bigger story of us. So President Patton, the question I want to pose to you here is just simply this. You know, Middlebury has these longstanding programs in conflict transformation and bridge building, and now has this great infusion of resource to go deeper on that. What have you learned in this work about how we can address these problems? We've done a lot in this panel here talking about and naming the challenges and the threats. What have you all learned at Middlebury about the solution side?
Well, thanks, Eric. It's wonderful to see you and wonderful to be part of this conversation. We have just started our grant, so we can sort of say what we learned to get to this point, and then maybe talk a little bit about what we'd like to accomplish and what we hope to learn to share with others. I think we've all seen the studies and heard the critiques about the teaching of civics in high schools, how that has waned, how higher education has become a kind of ground zero in the culture wars and political polarization. And I think our students, for these reasons and post-COVID, need to develop skills to create what I frequently call a robust and inclusive public square. And those two words, both robust and inclusive, are the two kinds of things that students really want to find a balance to. And what we've learned already is our students long to figure these questions out. They're with us and they are thinking about these issues all the time. And I think for higher ed, based on the Academy's bipartisan report, Our Common Purpose, which I know you have a physical copy of with you. One of the things that folks have really, the report as well as other areas of society have called higher ed to be one of the leaders in social, bonding social capital and bridging social capital. And so we feel that it's incumbent upon each of our institutions to respond to this call in their own unique ways. So one of the things we know and we've learned through higher ed is that through its admissions process and in its public platforms, it has access to a pipeline of students, both in high school, undergraduate, and in graduate school. And many colleges have programs already in political science, experiential learning, and many have graduate programs in social sciences, which is the beginning part of how we think about conflict transformation. And so we're learning that if we include these things that are already building blocks in higher education to build the basic skills of conflict transformation, then that is going to help with building the common purpose, creating a public good, and also preventing the kind of exploitability that you were talking about earlier. I think we learn from our students, they don't want to be exploitable. They want to have control over their media experience or social media experience, connections to ways to resist extremism, for example. And we have learned also that it's a skill that's increasingly emerging as a deep necessity for 21st century public life. So faculty and staff at Middlebury felt that we needed to do an inventory of what we already offered and at all different levels of higher ed, including the pipeline and postgrad, and gather faculty and staff who are interested in the work and make it part of our academic mission, make it part of our teaching and research mission. And so if we need to pivot in higher education, we need to conceive of conflict transformation as an essential educational good. We talk about it as conflict transformation as a liberal art here. And I wanna just focus on two different things here. The first is conflict transformation, the great theorist here, there are many, many, but Jean-Paul Lederach talks about it as, it's not a way of pushing conflict away. It's a way of accepting that conflict is gonna be part of our everyday lives. Our students know this, that is part of what we've learned already. And yet we want to think about it as a challenge to analyze the structures of conflict and then move the tension inherent in all conflict to a positive direction. And you saw that in the example of our two congressmen. Their tensions and their friendship are always going to exist, but what they've learned to do in practice is to move it in that positive direction. And that's a key piece that I think our students know and need to learn the skills to make that transition. The other thing that we're learning slowly is that difference is not something to be tolerated, to be overcome, to be celebrated. Of course, it's all those things. But if we look at society the way we look at biodiversity or the way we look at trade and barter, we actually need to think about difference as something that's needed. If I have apples and you have apples, and I can't trade with you in the same way, but if you have oranges, I can trade with you. We really need difference. And that's something that I think our students are longing to learn about and experience in really important ways. So we're hoping over the course of the 7 years of this grant to work with a number of local partners, and we're starting local to your points earlier. And that's been incredibly exciting as we move into people who are working in town halls, reaching out to us about how they're scaffolding conversations and staging conversations to make them more respectful over time and more productive. And that Local politics is where we're focusing initially, both in our global education, the local traditions of Paris or in Africa, as well and in Vermont, as well as the more broad focus on the national and international challenges that are presented to us and our students.
Well, this is very inspiring and motivating, and I want to return in a moment to Dr. Pandith and Ambassador Hutchison. But one thing I want to name in what you just said, President Patton, is kind of remarkable, I think, for a lot of college campuses right now, which is getting creating an environment where students get comfortable with conflict. Just that baseline, you go to many campuses today, and that's the thing they want to avoid. That's the thing they want to steer away from, and end up kind of just keeping their views to themselves because they don't want to get canceled or they don't want to create a tempest of some kind. And, you know, we've got a project at the Aspen Institute called the Better Arguments Project. And its premise is simply that, you know, as polarized and toxic as our politics may be right now, we don't need fewer arguments in American civic life. We just need less stupid ones, right? Yeah. We need to do everything that you're describing at Middlebury, actually learning how to have argument in a constructive way, how to embrace the idea that America is an argument. Right. And when Ambassador Hutchison, when you were in the Senate, you knew that you knew the kind of arguments of principle that you would have across party lines on issue after issue. And we are meant to be perpetually contesting strong national government versus local control, an emphasis on liberty versus an emphasis on freedom, focus on pluribus versus focus on unum. Right. There's always a tug of war and a tension there. And how we as Americans build that skill to navigate those, not treat things as totally binary, is certainly, Dr. Pandith put it, it's a whole of society effort, right? As the pandemic response should have been. And Ambassador Hutchison, I want to kind of have you put your senator hat back on, if it still fits, and just remember, like, you know, think about what is it, what else would you, I mean, you heard about this legislation that has been introduced by the two members of Congress. What else can Congress be doing right now? What could the administration be doing? What could the federal government be doing to support these kinds of activities that are happening either at the local faith community level or at the community or college campus level?
Well, first let me say to Laurie at Middlebury, I'm sorry, that I was so pleased that she acknowledged that we need something to start at the really middle school and high school level for her to have a chance to really develop this on the college campuses. And it is that our young people, I sent my kids to great schools, but they came home just dragging about America, because all they ever learned about was the problems. They didn't learn about how the problems were solved, and it was a great thing that it was solved, and the greatness of America, the greatness of people speaking and being able to vote on their elected officials. There was nothing about the greatness of America. It was all about all the problems we had that truly are bad problems, but never about the greatness of being able to settle those. So I do thank you very much, Lori, for bringing that out. When I put on my Senate hat, I think there are two things, and I'm gonna go back into the politics, because what we need to do is fix people being interested in primaries. Right now, people think of elections as the general election, and people do get exercised and they do vote, but less so in primaries. And there are more independents out there that don't vote in a primary. And that's what makes the fringes be the nominees that you then have to choose between in an election. And I would urge people to, and our senators, our state legislatures especially, to look at the primary system and have primaries that would promote more interaction in the primary level, so that you have the candidates that are more appealing to the general population that are your choices in the general election. So that's at the very base that I think has to be part of learning how to have conflict resolution. It's that you don't elect the fringes, but the fringes are nominated in primaries, and independents never seem to understand. You can vote generally in most states, you can vote in either primary. Look at your candidates and where the chances are that those candidates, which party is going to really be favored to win. And if the candidates are really different from you, look with an open mind to voting in primaries. That would be my first thing. But on the Senate side, and among elected officials, I think you'll see what you saw with those congressmen today, because some of my best friends are Democrats. I was chairman and ranking member on different, depending on who was in the majority, with Dianne Feinstein. She's one of my best friends. Barbara Mikulski, one of my best friends, because we worked together in committees. We figured out what was the most important priority from their thought and our thought, and we made those priorities come together. And we used to get unanimous votes in the Senate for our committee reports that came out, because we worked together at that level. And I think in general in the Senate, people do have friends across party lines, and they're able to have civil discourse. You can see fiery speeches on the floor, but then they'll go have lunch together, or the women senators have dinners together regularly. And sometimes it's not just women or men, but people do gather in Republicans and Democrats, even if they disagree. They are respectful because they know that a whole state has voted to elect these people. So you are respectful of their representing their states. And so I think what Lori's challenge is a good one, to recognize conflict and recognize that we can have differences, but listening to each other and seeing where there is common ground, listening to what are the priorities. Maybe we disagree on this issue, but we are allies on the other issue.
And I'm going to jump in there, Ambassador, and in our last couple of minutes, invite Farah Pandith and Lori Patton each to speak for a minute on this question. I think, Lori, you know, for you, Farah Pandith, what you were alluding to earlier in lessons learned from these last 20 years of radicalization and so on and so forth, must be some things about de-radicalization, right? What's worked in de-radicalizing people from those fringes, from the need to kind of hold on to extremist worldviews? What have you learned there that we can actually take some hope from? And then President Patton, to you, you know, what is giving you hope on campus right now?
Eric, one of the things that is positive, because we're at the end of the hour and I want to leave us on a positive note, solutions are available and affordable right now. What we know is how to inoculate communities from having people be interested in the ideology of us versus them. And we do that by putting into the system many different touch points. So culturally, you brought up the issue of culture. Culturally, they are hearing and seeing things that move them away from the interest around how to be a particular person in a particular way. One phrase we didn't use at all today was identity and belonging. And what we know from 20 years of work in understanding how people get radicalized is that it comes down to how people are thinking about themselves. That happens inside of themselves before something happens on the outside. So what can we be doing to build antibodies in the system? We can do that through some of the things that obviously President Patton has already listed in terms of how we talk about each other, what we're building into the system, but also, quite frankly, it's things where we are looking at understanding where influencers matter. Who are the people that we value in a community? And are they teaching us to listen with civility and compassion? Are we learning things about ourselves that are truthful, as opposed to misinformation and disinformation about what it means to be a particular thing? Eric, there are certainly many other things that we can do. I would wrote a whole book on it, but I do want to just say, if we don't focus on identity and belonging, we're missing the main thing that will allow us to inoculate communities.
Well, President Patton, last word to you.
Great, thank you, Eric. I think what we are seeing is our students really want to learn these skills, and once we make them available to them, they are seeing ways in which their own conflicts can be resolved or addressed or managed through these skills. So for example, if there's something that would have created a conflagration on campus earlier, now they can say, I think this is a moment for us to do restorative practices or conflict mediation. And they're also learning that it's an everyday art. It's very quotidian. And I'll end with a hopeful story. I grew up in Salem, Massachusetts. And a lot of people don't know the how the witchcraft trials ended and people got back together. It was incredibly emotional. It was extremely local. It was about the Salem Village and Salem City. I grew up in Salem Village. And the parish where most of the people were, where there were people who were accused, people whose families were hung as witches, incredibly intense. The person who came in after all of the events of 1692 was a minister named Joseph Green. And the first thing that Joseph Green did was rearrange the seats in the church and made sure everybody sat in different places than they normally had sat. And he gave a sermon and worked with every single individual person so that people who had been involved in that conflict addressed it, named the pain, and talked about what they were going to do moving forward. And this was in the 17th century America. So the study, the historical study of post-conflict management also can inspire us to address the state of polarization today. So I'll end with that historical story of hope.
What a fantastic story, and just a taste of how we could have spent two more hours together in this conversation, but I'm so grateful to all three of you, Ambassador Kay Bailey Hutchison, Farah Pandith, and President Lori Patton from Middlebury. So grateful for the examples you're all setting and the ideas you're putting out there. And let me turn it back over here to David Oxtoby to close us out.
Good. Thank you, Eric. What an excellent program. I also want to thank Representatives Andy Barr and Derek Kilmer and our panelists, Ambassador Kay Bailey Hutchison, President Lori Patton, and Ms. Farah Pandith for the time and for your contributions today. And thank you, Eric, for your able moderation and for your service to the Commission on the Practice of Democratic Citizenship. I invite all members of the audience to explore the Our Common Purpose report and other resources at our website. I encourage everyone in our audience also to continue the essential work of bringing Americans together and strengthening our nation. Be well.